Good afternoon, everyone. Our dear students here in our city, our students in Malaya, in Makua, Makati, and also to the Malaya High School of Science in Pandanta. This is really a very exciting day for us. This is the first time ever that we have held a seminar that is being seen in five campuses of the Makua system of schools. Isn't that something? Not only for the people who are coming to the seminar room of Makua in Nahuros, we have a live stream in our Facebook fan account. So, you guys maybe in the chimney right now could be watching this seminar, could be anywhere. So this summary of giving the objective of Malayan College Seminar to be a digital campus, but more importantly, to be the content of the thinking that we introduce to the digital system. I'm so glad that attorney Naguib G, Sinarimbo has agreed to become our speaker for this afternoon. As you know, we have stated that one of the objectives also of MCM would be to have a Mindanao setting.
And the related symbol of the platform, the answer is in 1989, when the first organic law was drafted, these six municipalities and the 39 villages in North Tobago already said yes, they wanted cure. There was a challenge, of course, about the determination of majority. And so they were likely going to withdraw. In 2001, with the whole city of the Muslim was affected to be expanded to a legislation, these same municipalities in the North Tobago, 39 barangays in North Tobago also said yes, they want to join the autonomous Italy for Sinarimbo. But because the plebiscite question was framed in such a way that you need a double majority, a majority for the municipalities and a majority at the level of the province, these municipalities were not able to join the Bangsamoro or autonomous Italy for Sinarimbo. The same is the case with the 39 barangays. And then you have the cities of Cotabato and Isabela, and more importantly, other contiguous areas where there is a resolution of the local government unit, where we issue at least 10% of the registered voters. How is it actually operationalized? If you have, for instance, there are other villages in North Cotabato that are contiguous, meaning attached to the 39. Or at least attached to the existing province of Mindanao, they may either petition, that is the registered voters, 10% of them, may file a petition at the competency we want to join the Department of Legacy. If they do that, then they will be included in the legacy. Another way of joining is that if the legislative branch of the local government unit pass a resolution saying that they will join, then they can join the legacy. The blessing happens from the period of 90 days to 150 days after the law has been signed by the president. So roughly around December or January, he used that. Legacy. The other component of the economy is actually this one. Landmass and water. This one. Water is divided body pertains to inland waters. Inland waters are lakes, rivers, and marshes. Generally, it is inside the land mass, it will be part of that territory. The exception is if it is an inland water that supplies energy or electricity to a power generating plant. Or if the water of the inland water is connected to a power generating facility that supplies energy to territories outside, it will be co-managed. It's not an exclusive domain of the Bangsamoro. An example of this is Lake Lanao, the one that supplies water to the power generating facilities along the Agus River. For the ionified water, which is really the Bangsamoro water, the Bangsamoro water pertains to a part of the sea which is started from the portions of, if you are looking at the map of Finland, that includes portions of the water wall as well as that of the Sulu Sea. So parts of Sulu Sea in the water wall would become, if the law is satisfied in the plebiscite, would become part of the territory of the Bangsamoro. Some of the principles that I think is important to share with you includes self-governance as a principle. Essentially, this one pertains to the issue of the right, the privilege of people to define what they want, how they want it, and who should perform these functions. So, part of the assertion is that the Bangsamoro, before they were included in the human republic, were deciding for themselves. Governance, self-governance. More technically, territory is self-determination, internal self-determination. So the Bangsamoro is granted the authority to govern themselves within the framework of the constitution. That is, if you do the things, the powers that are granted you, provided it is within the framework of the constitution, you can do it. So you can decide on your own. The other principle that is important to understand is the electoral system in the Bangsamoro would be a big difference from our what they believe are essential principles in government. there is an assurance on respecting the rights of non-war indigenous people. This is the an issue that was tested from the negotiating panels of the government and the role of the relation of the question of how do we ensure and what are the rights that we should grant to minorities inside this minority. So minorities within a minority was an essential issue that has been addressed by our manager. So there's a guarantee for indigenous people who are not normal. Natives who are not necessarily normal. They don't ascribe to identity normal, but they are natives of this place. The likes of Tagalog, Malabos, and some other non-moral indigenous in the Bangsamoro. The other one that's important in the feature of the law is that it adopted a parliamentary form of government. The basic distinction between what we currently have in the Philippines, which is a copy of the form of government in the US, is that in a parliamentary system, there is a fusion of the legislative and the executive. So only one, which is the parliament. Inside the parliament, you will have a cabinet that actually executes the laws adopted by the parliament. But nonetheless, it is a single body. The parliament is a single body. It is unlike the Philippines, where you have Congress and the Senate, which is separate from that of the executive department under the government that is happening. In the parliamentary form of government, you will have a parliament inside the parliament, a majority of them will constitute the cabinet. The head of the cabinet would be the chief minister. So the legislative authority pertains, is held by the parliament. In the law, the number of the members of the parliament is 80, unless it is increased by Congress. These 80 members of the parliament is distributed into the following. 50%, as I was saying, will be party representatives. So this half of the parliament will be elected to a party system. So you elect the party, not the individuals. But you will still have district representatives. This time around, in the districts, you elect the individual. Even if the individual is a member of the party. So if you are an individual, you are not in a district, but you are a member of the party, the electorate will still vote for you and not the party. And then, to ensure that you have representation to minority groups who will not win in an election if it is conducted across the region, we make sure that there will be resources and sectoral representatives, at least 10%. So if it is 80, and 80 of the members of the parliament will come from sectoral representatives of resources. There are two resources. One resource is for non-moral indigenous people. So that the Gawais, the Lambalian, the Malabos would have two seats in the parliament. The sectors would have two seats also, sure. So then you have a seat. They don't have to go in the parliament election. Then you have seats so that they have a voice in the parliament. There are also seats allocated for traditional leaders, for youth, and for women. So they will have a seat. So everyone will have a voice in the parliament. The way the parliament has been designed is to ensure that you have a voice for everyone. The other important feature of the Bangsamoro government is the introduction of a ceremonial development in the Bangsamoro. In the UK, ensures that he is about the politics in the parliament. So there is a council of leaders that nominates several names to become the wali. It is submitted to the parliament passes a resolution, each person itself, in effect saying who becomes the wali. Once that is done, he assumes the office and then starts his ordinary duties that includes that of opening the parliament. This one I discussed with you already, executive authority. You will note that the execution of the law pertains to the cabinet. The cabinet is headed by the chief minister. The majority of the members of the cabinet will come from the parliament. So you need to be a member of the parliament for you to become a member of the cabinet. But there will also be some members of the cabinet who will not be members of the parliament, because there will be a situation where you want a technical person to head a ministry, but you don't have a technical person elected in the parliament. So the chief minister is given the role to pick someone outside of the parliament to become part of the cabinet. So that adjustment is made to ensure that we are not forced to deal with people who may not have necessarily technical competence to run the appropriate ministry. So the chief minister is given that privilege. Also, to ensure that there is a balance in terms of representation among the major groups in the Bangsamoro, the chief minister needs to include two deputy chief ministers. The deputy will come from an area where, or not from the area where the chief minister is elected. So, for instance, if the chief minister is from Central Mindanao, essentially from Cotabato, part of Cotabato, or Mindanao, or Cotabato City, the two deputies must come from Lanao and the island provinces. If the chief minister is elected from the island provinces, the two deputies must come from Maguindanao, Cotabato, and Lanao del Sur and Lanao del Norte. That's to ensure the balance in terms of representation in the government of the Bangsamoro. Then, I briefly discussed with you the powers of the Bangsamoro government. As I was telling you earlier, it has always been an issue that beginning from the Spanish colonial period, the central meeting in government and service was dedicated from the top, from Manila. And so you have a popular cliche or popular protest for most of us from the periphery that there is an imperial Manila that dictates everything. And it is, of course, an incident of history. So the Spaniards conquered the islands from the north and in the middle, the only way they can control it is to strengthen a central national government. So all the central meaning away from the center. Everyone just needs to follow. That has been for us for hundreds of years. And what if I the policy? And you can see it physically in Manila is that a lot of people flock to Manila. So we have an overpopulation. Why is that? Because opportunities are in Manila. Schools are in Manila. And I'm happy to see a whole county in Manila, which is at least an additional power of the periphery. But for a long time, we always have the best schools in Manila, the best hospitals in Manila. And so in Manila, you constructed bridges without beavers, because your cars cannot be accommodated by those. And so you build bridges even if there are no beavers. But in Mindanao, you have doors that you don't have bridges. That has been the situation for a long time. This development was triggered by an already centralized administration and governance in the Philippines for a long time. And therefore, the demand is that we should have powers almost certain areas of governance. And so you have an enumeration of the powers of the Bangsamoro government in Article 5, Section 2 of the law. Roughly, the enumeration is all 50. I'm counting 55. There are powers that are spread across the law. I'll tell you something of the powers granted to Bangsamoro. This one includes, for instance, administrative organization, administration of justice, assessment of the natural resources, entertainment and training, capacity land service, civil service, classification of public lands, education, skills training. These powers now would belong to the Bangsamoro within the limits of the constitution. So, mostly, central government would no longer exercise the list that are enumerated in Section 2, Article 5 of this law. That effect really is to ensure that decisions are taken at the level of government that is closest to the people. So the problems are really understood and solutions are made on the basis of problems that are made at the level closest to the people. My experience in government is that a lot of decisions taken from the top do not match problems better. I can cite certain examples given by years of service in the government's media business. With fire trucks were distributed, they included in the municipalities for distribution of fire trucks. Sipangkay is an island municipality in Tagalabi that don't have roads because it's in the middle of the sea, several small islands. So you can't bring a fire truck there because there are no roads, but they were included by the IIT for distribution of fire trucks. So he said, why do you bring fire trucks in the island of Sipangkay? There's no use for it. Why? Because decisions were taken from the top. So those people in Manila who decide to the natural law, what's exactly the problem for the world? So this attempt at bringing down the powers to a level of government that has close to people is an attempt to address the gap. There is more. So I was telling you, it's a lack of powers. Now, to help you imagine, I have a graphic representation of the parliament. The parliament you see in yellow is 80. Of the 80, a person will serve as members of the cabinet. So there is a parallel in terms of those doing legislation work. So you see a parallel between the cabinet and legislation. Those are people who are members of the parliament and who are at the same time members of the cabinet. Because it is a requirement that the majority of the cabinet would come from the parliament. But also, outside of that, the chief minister may appoint a member of the cabinet who is not necessarily a member of the parliament. So outside the yellow, there can be people who included as members of the cabinet who are not necessarily members of the parliament. The parliament by far is the most powerful institution of government in the Bangsamoro because it combines the legislative and executive powers of government. Below that would be the bureaucracy. It is important to understand that you need a strong bureaucracy in the parliamentary system because there is a possibility that the parliament will be dissolved when a vote of confidence is taken against the government of the cabinet that he has decided. You might have a situation where the cabinet is dissolved and the parliament is
Programs about
building hospitals and health centers in the villages. This work also continue, but that's more important. We also allocate the pandemic resources into funding the national government undertake these programs. But there is a chance that this program will continue to be employed by the constituencies of the Bangsamoro. And then, I was telling you that the system that Bangsamoro question is also a part of that is about Sharia law and the religious system of the Muslims. There is an accommodation for this through the implementation of Sharia with limited jurisdiction. Person, family, relations, conversion of substance, and minor criminal offenses. So, jurisdiction has been granted the Sharia courts. We also recognize the existence of regular courts in the Bangsamoro. So, the municipal trial courts, the regional trial courts in the Bangsamoro will continue to run. And we have very restricted on our visas. But there will also be a justice system for non-moral indigenous people. So their traditional system of resolving their property will continue to be considered as
granted the
answer is no, it will be 100% Bangsamoro. If these are taxes collected by the National Internal Revenue or the Bureau of Internal Revenue, because it is under the National Internal Revenue Code, the sharing is 25% goes to national, 75% goes to Bangsamoro. In addition, the collection of these taxes, because a larger part of the taxes goes to Bangsamoro, it will now be collected by Bangsamoro. 25% is already to central government. Other than the taxes, there is also sharing in terms of the resources derived from the exploration, development, and utilization of natural resources, so mines and minerals. These are mines and minerals other than this enumeration. If it is not energy resources, it is 100% Bangsamoro. So for instance, gold, nickel, silver, that's 100% Bangsamoro. If it is oil, gas, coal, uranium, the sharing is 50-50. 50% goes to that, 50% goes to the Bangsamoro. And for instance, you have natural gas discovered in the Ligwasa Marsh. If it is exploited, that the sharing percentage, because it is an energy resource, will be 50-50. But if gold is discovered, for instance, in Ubi, in the province of Mindanao, then it will pertain exclusively to Bangsamoro. 100% of that goes to the Bangsamoro. So that's the resource that will be given to Bangsamoro. Of course, beyond this, you will have other sources of funds, which is important. The tax base in Bangsamoro is very low, so we cannot survive on the basis of taxes generated in Bangsamoro. You cannot impose additional taxes because you are the poorest people in the region. If you impose additional taxes, then you will suffer. So what we've done is to allocate an annual land grant to the Bangsamoro. The system of the annual land grant is that you will have a collection coming from the Bureau of Internal Revenue. These are taxes collected from all over the country. 5% of the net of the collection goes automatically to the Bangsamoro. Also, 5% of the net collection of the Bureau of Customs. These are tariffs or these are impositions made to the Bureau of Customs for goods entering the country. The total collection per man, 5% of the net goes to the Bangsamoro. So in all, you will have 5% of the net of the internal revenue collection as well as the customs collection in the whole government. This one is automatically appropriated and regularly released to the Bangsamoro. How different is that system from the current system in the Autonomous Region? It is totally different. Because in the current arrangement in the Autonomous Region, you need to submit a budget to Congress through the DPMI. And then you go to Congress and you define your budget. In turn, Congress can actually reduce your budget tremendously. So it is a system where you are forced to pay for your money in Congress. In the system of an annual grant, you don't have to go to Congress. As soon as the collection is made, you make a deduction of all the allowable deductions in the internal revenue, multiply it by 5%, then you get the share. It is automatically appropriate. You don't have to deduct it in Congress. And then it is regularly released to the Bangsamoro. This land grant now will be allocated by the Bangsamoro Bank to an appropriation zone. So instead of Congress determining your priorities and your needs and your problems, it is done by the society. What are the areas where we invest our money? What's our priority? If innovation is our priority, what are the problems that we need to pursue? How much money we spend for it? So the determination of the priorities on the assumption that determining also the problems in independently resolved is now made by the fire, or not by the Congress of the Philippines. That's a substantial improvement in the current setup. You also have 50 million, which is allocated over the period of 10 years. Every year, you receive 2 million, which in turn will be decided by through a Bangsamoro plan, which will invest in the communities that have been affected by the war. To rehabilitate the community, you will be using this fund, 50 million. Then, on natural opportunity and economy, the question of natural resources has been a persistent problem in the negotiations as well as in the relations in Congress. Why is that so? Because resources entails money. Resources also, or some of us, do not only entail money, but also defines our identity. Why is that? Because for some people, the resource is attached to their identity. For instance, the people of the village, the Malagados, do not only see it as a resource, it is seen as a source of that identity. The Malagados are called Malagados simply because they are people from the village. If you take away the village, you're not only taking out the resources, but also taking out their identity. So this has been a bloody issue in the negotiations. The way you resolve this is to go around the issue of ownership. So we did not discuss ownership here. What we discuss here is jurisdiction over the natural resources and shared state for exploiting the resources. Substantial part of the resources will now pertain to the Bangsamoro. But also, for some of these resources, you will need to coordinate with central government, because some of the exploitation of the resource will trigger problems down below. So if you, for instance, you exploit the lake tremendously, you might deploy the power plants along the Atty River from the water that is needed for running the power plants. The supply is electricity, not just for illegal or border Mindanao, but the whole of Mindanao. So it is essential to look at the bigger picture for some of these sources. So, you need to have a binding law before you have to proceed with exploiting mines and minerals. And then you have this issue which is close to some people. So how is the Bangsamoro constituent? How will it come into being? So there is a process for enacting the legislation, which thankfully has been completed, so you now have an organic law for the Bangsamoro. This law will not be effective unless it is ratified by the people. Why is that? Because that is what the constitutional requirement of the Constitution says, that organic law becomes effective only if it is subjected to a plebiscite. And so how will the plebiscite be undertaken? There will be an enumeration of the territories that will be included in the plebiscite. The first in the enumeration is the geographic area of the AOA. So the 5 provinces of the current AOA will vote as one unit. And so the determination of the majority is the totality of the votes cast by the whole region, not by the provinces. So if the majority is obtained, then the whole of the current area becomes a part of the Bangsamoro. For the municipalities in the province of Lagao del Norte, you need a governing authority. So there is a set of questions for the 6 municipalities, which would roughly be a question of, do you want to join? If a majority said yes, then you need a consent of the whole of the province of Kalawagon. If the rest of the 82 would need to consent. So a set of questions will also be for the other municipality of the government to be
Thank you.